Our third Crypto Monday. The series started last year, or last semester, when we started the Crypto Economics Institute. Ever since, we've had a lot of events ourselves in the form of Crypto Mondays, but also other events like Bimo Matters. Last time, together with Guido, who is also here, another Bimo Matters will be happening next week, where Alfred Nordes will be speaking. So you see that we have many events. This event today is dedicated to analyzing Steemit as a social media platform. The evening today is divided into four parts. Part number one, I'm going to ask two Steemit users to join me here and talk about their Steemit experience. Steemit has been up and running and live for over 2 years now, almost 3 years. And we have one of the earliest adopters here who started using Steemit, and they will tell us how Steemit works from a user perspective. After that, I would ask two of our researchers of our Crypto Economics Institute. Jan will be talking about how the platform works, not from a really very technical perspective, but like the mechanisms of the platform and the advantages, but also the disadvantages and what we can learn from that. And then Guido Schlingel will come on board and tell us about the monetary policy aspects, especially of the Steemit token. So I really would like to start, but one of our users, she left and she's not here, and we wanted to start with her, so I don't know where she is. Nicoletta, do you know where she is? She's coming. Okay, so I will ask Cindy and Chris to join me briefly on stage. All right, thank you. I'm so sorry for being late. Okay, so please sit down here. We decided to have a small interview-like situation rather than a podcast situation. I would like to introduce to you Chris and Cindy. Chris, I've known for a long time. He is an artist, and I think because I told him a lot about blockchain and Steemit. At some point, he went on Steemit, looked at it, and ever since he's been a user. So thank you for coming. He helped us understand how the platform works from a user perspective, and we'll share some of his experience here. He highly recommended to invite Cindy because they met at the Steemit Stammtisch here in Vienna, which you co-founded, is that correct?
Yes.
Yes.
I mean, it was with some help with a couple of very important Steemians as well.
Okay,
I was not alone doing this.
Okay, so maybe welcome both, and thanks for being here. Maybe I start with you, Cindy. Can you tell us, because for many people, Steemit is abstract. When did you discover Steemit, and how, since when have you been using it, and what's your experience with it?
Okay. First of all, I would like to say that I had no idea before I heard about Steemit what is cryptocurrency, what is a Bitcoin, or anything similar like that. All what I was interested in was I wanted to unblock my writer's block because I wanted to write a book, but I didn't feel comfortable in writing. So there is one thing I remember from a very nice poet. He says, "You seek what is seeking you." So Steemit was finding me by accident. I was in Bali in my house, had a wonderful life there. I work in the music business, in the music industry, booking DJs, booking artists. I had no idea of writing a blog at all. So one of my friends from Canada, who lives also in Bali, Indonesia, sent me an article about a very interesting topic he thought that I should read about. And then I said, "One moment." At the end of this article was like rewards, $1,600. So it was not about the money, but I was curious, logically, because what is this? And what is Steemit? I never heard about that before. explained that, that he started writing for this platform, social media platform, and it's very similar to Facebook, but a little bit more complicated. And you can make a lot of money. And I'm like, writing and money, that works. Let me open an account, and that's it. And then I started. And that was June 2016. And Steemit was born, I think it was in May 2016. So I was just 1 month behind. Now, okay, I continue because that's now interesting. So it took me quite some time. I think I started reading the article in May, but I didn't open an account because I didn't know the password, the keys, you have to keep the password. And I cannot even remember my simple password. So how can I remember that long key thing? And then there were 4 of them. So I was really, really dizzy, confused. I had no idea what I'm gonna do. But I started reading about how you use Steemit, what is a blockchain, what is a hard fork. I had no idea what a hard fork is. I read and read day and night. I was like a lunatic, like a maniac. So I said, now I do it, and then I'm writing down everything. And that's how I started with the first login.
So what was the content of your first blog post?
It was about Mamacita, which is me, because that was my username.
Okay, so it was a personal entry. What was it about blockchain?
It was very personal.
How many kind of followers do you have
today? I have now about 6,700.
I mean, it's transparent if we look how much money have you made. You started being able to live, right?
Yes. Steemit is a lifestyle in me. It is my lifestyle. It can be anybody's lifestyle, and you can really live very well. You can travel. You can ride everywhere wherever you go. So yes, I financed my last 2 years. But not right away, of course, because my first post was very boring. I put like a few interesting things inside. I thought it was quite okay, and I was waiting for the first comments from people, other Steemers, but I didn't dare to look at the article and the results. So I'm like looking and looking and looking, and I'm like 0.74 cents. And I'm like, no, I'm not doing this.
So
I got 0.74 cents for my first article. And I tell you also why. I don't think my article was that bad. But the same day, the whole system changed. They wanted to go from the technical Steemit atmosphere. They wanted to go into mainstream. So the investors, they are very important on Steemit. It's a little bit also of a disadvantage, but okay, they are very powerful if they have a lot of investment in the platform, and they can vote you up or down or whatever they want. So they decided, a group of people, not transparent, not that transparent, some of them are, they decided to give a lot of rewards to a young lady who was posting about a makeup tutorial. How you put makeup on Steemit. That was a big breakthrough, and she made how much? $36,000.
For one post.
For one post.
Okay.
So I was crushed.
So can you just before I get to Chris, explain, so on Steemit, and we'll hear it later, you can't always make when you post something and other people like it, based on the reputation that the other people have, you can earn money. So if somebody else has a lot of reputation tokens, Steem Power, you can earn more money.
Okay, reputation is one thing. That means how active you are on the platform. The more articles you write and the more posts you make, which means post is comments, the more reputation points you get, and you're growing. I'm at 69, which is a pretty good, okay number. The best ones are, I think, what, 73, 75 already, 69. It depends also how much, how how many rewards you made that pushing you even more up. I never was on the front line. I've never been a superstar on the platform. But I started having my own followers. I became an inspiration and motivation for my group of people, and that was important for me. So reputation is one thing, and steam power is something else. The steam power is how much money you have invested in the platform. It can be also from your rewards. You never took them out. The first year I didn't take out anything. I was just collecting, writing. Every 2 days I was writing. And that got me steam power, which means people wanted to comment on my posts. Maybe they were not that great, but they comment because they know my vote is worth more than somebody else's vote who's new.
So for those who haven't used Steemit, if you comment or like a post that from somebody with a lot of steam power, and we will hear this later in detail by Jan, you will get a reward, which is, and it will be more if the post you like has more steam power, and vice versa.
And I also get something back in return. And so I'm learning even if I'm voting for others.
Yes. So you earn for posting, and you earn for voting, but only for posts that have been voted by other people, they will get rewards. We will look at the mechanics later in detail. I think the important thing is to see that you've been able to make quite a good living, but also because you've been one of the early adopters.
That's one reason for sure. It's definitely much more difficult if you sign up now. It's very complicated because the reward pool doesn't have that much. I don't know how to explain that though. Anyways, it's more complicated.
Yeah,
it's more complicated now if you're a new user, but it was not only for that reason. That was an advantage for sure. But the other thing, what I think was my success on the platform, I was very, very much engaged with every other user, meaning I have 18,600 posts. That's insane. That means I was really working together and communicating and engaging with other people's posts, meaning I make them feel good, that they wrote something interesting. So this makes the second.
You were very active.
Yes, you have to be active. You cannot expect that you open up an account and then things happen by itself. I really enjoyed it. I really enjoyed to look into different communities, to build like a global family. I know people all around the world. I went to visit them. Wherever I go, it's like, hey, what's up, you know? And then it's so beautiful because you create a community not only in your home place, the whole world opens up in front of you. And that was the interesting thing for me, because I got a little bit bored in Bali. It was too beautiful.
But I think one important thing is you're not a tech aficionado, right? So
no,
you know how to use computers, that's it.
Well, two fingers.
Yes.
Two fingers.
Yeah, and you have the story.
I didn't know how to write blog.
There is this misconception that early adopters of blockchain are technical adept people. Can I also ask you how old you are?
You can. I was born 1958, which makes me 60 since September 20. So I'm officially pensionist in Austria, which is great, because I can travel wherever I want with my computer and write my articles and make my income. And I don't even have to tell them. No, I have to.
Okay, Chris, maybe we'll get back to you.
Okay, one more thing I want to say. I didn't grow up with internet. I didn't grow up with a smartphone. I had to teach myself how to use a computer. And I come from a different era. I was not scared of that. I just went for it. And I have so many young people around me through Steemit who are teaching me a lot of things. And we built so many amazing communities around that it's a very good feeling for me.
Okay.
I feel worth more than I maybe thought before. I don't know. I like.
Okay. So Chris, maybe pass on the when did you go online exactly?
My first account was in 2016, and the second account 2017.
What happened to your first account?
I lost my keys. So. $3,000.
Okay,
it's not so much, but maybe it depends on the market capital. So,
So because you lost your keys, you had to open a new account. And what do you post there?
I post art, blogs,
okay, so
short stories.
So your art, pictures of your art, and your writings. Mm-hmm.
And the reason why I'm using Steven is because it's not Facebook. So it's good. It's the only reason.
So what is the advantage for you?
There are no censorship like Facebook, because Facebook always deleted my account, and on Steven it's not possible to get deleted.
Yes. Because you do explicit art, which sometimes shows sexual parts.
Yeah, sexual parts, very violent, satire.
And your account got frozen various times on Facebook.
On Facebook. And it's not just 6 days offline, it's just a year or something, 30 days, a year, and so on.
And they don't communicate with you.
And they don't communicate, yes.
And at some point, randomly, they open your account again or something.
Yes, just one year later, the account is working.
And you don't know why.
And along the way.
Okay. So, how has your experience on Steemit been? You told me it's an interesting sociological experience. What do you mean, more or less?
I think it's the same shit like the reality, because there are many groups with power and there are a lot of groups with no power, and so the reality is also great. The way is they have the money, and the way is to make the rules, and then there are the plankton and the short fishes, yeah? They don't have something power, and yes, that's I think that's the little dilemma of Steam, but it's the better version and
So for now I would say thank you for sharing the experience. We would invite our researchers to explain us Steam in depth, so you guys get full knowledge of how it works. And then I would like to invite you back after the two keynotes. So we can have a big discussion together with our keynote speakers. Okay? Thanks for that.
It's a massive honeypot of personal data, which is really difficult to protect against. 100%, it's exploited by people like Trump and Theresa May. And overall, there's just a lack of transparency and accountability, as we've heard from the bad user experience just now. So it's about time we had something better. So here comes Steemit. It's currently one of the top 40 most valuable cryptocurrencies, so almost $250 million worth of tokens on the market. And they have slightly more than 1 million users. Those are not active users, those are user accounts. So this is what it looks like. It's basically a block platform. So if you know Medium, it's very similar. So you can see all these posts on your feed, and you can click through and go into each and every one of them. But it also borrowed some ideas from websites like Reddit. So you can upvote and downvote all the posts and comments, and you can see that the rewards. The monetary reward for each post is kind of front and center, so you can see immediately how much money each one of these posts will pay to their creator. So it is a three-part system. So here's where it gets slightly more complex. So there are three moving parts. One of them is the Steem token, which is the one that you can buy on an exchange, the one that is easily tradable, and you can send it to another person. It's an inflationary token. So at the moment, the rate of inflation is around 8% a year, and it will decrease in time, but never disappear. And then Once you have these tokens, you can lock them into a smart contract, which will increase your Steem power. So that's the second part of the system. So Steem power represents your reputation, and that directly translates to the effect of all your votes. So if you have a lot of Steem power, you can really push some of these posts up or down, depending on your votes. So the Steem power cannot be transferred to another person, but it can be delegated. So Steemit is a self-governed system where people can vote for the block producers, which are the people who actually produce the blocks in the blockchain. So one of the rights of the Steem power user is to be able to vote for one of these block producers. So the more Steem power you have, the more votes you have, and you can also delegate these votes and let somebody else vote for you. So you can, in this way, you can transfer the reputation to somebody else. And then the third part is Steem dollar, which the next speaker will be talking more about. It's essentially a stable coin pegged to the US dollar, which serves as a store of value. So, okay, this isn't perfect, but this is the mining reward distribution. So every 3 seconds, a new block is created on the Steemit blockchain, and this largest yellow part is actually the proportion of the reward that gets redistributed to the creators of the posts. So they get around 56% of the block reward. And the curators are the people who vote on the posts or comment on them. And then you have 10% to the miners, so the block producers themselves, they get to keep 10% of the rewards, and the rest goes as a reward to people who own Steem power. So if you have your tokens locked in this smart contract, you automatically get this kind of reward just for holding the reputation token. So here's kind of how it works. So the unstaked tokens, that is the exchange tradable STEMI token. So if you just buy them on an exchange, they will be subject to inflation and you will be slowly bleeding money. So what most people do and what the system incentivizes you to do is to lock them into the smart contract to increase your voting power and also get a much larger share of the mining rewards. So it's actually slightly more complicated than that as well. Okay, this didn't fit either. So a small part of the rewards goes to the inactive holders of Steam Power. So if you just hold your reputation token, you will get a small share of the rewards. But the larger share, which you can't see, the larger part goes to the active users. So as we heard from the speaker before, the system will reward the most active users in this way. So they will get the largest share of the mining rewards. Okay, so here's kind of the life cycle. I already said some parts of this. So first of all, you need to get some, if you want to enter the ecosystem, you need to get some Steam tokens, so you purchase them for your dollars or Bitcoin, and these are subject to the yearly inflation. Then what you do is you lock your tokens to get Steam Power, so to increase the impact of your votes and to increase the amount of rewards you get. And then you can start posting content, you can vote, you can comment, and you will get the rewards in the form of more Steam Power and the stablecoin, the Steam dollar. Right, so why is it important to increase your reputation? So here's my brand new account that I created a couple of days ago. And you can see, just be careful, there's e to the minus 6. So the value of my upvote as a new user is, it's a very small number. Whereas Dan, who is one of the creators of Steemit, his upvote is $1.50, which is roughly 180,000 times more. So you can see that there's really disproportionate power distributed to the big users and the small users. So if you want to matter at all on the Steemit network, you will need to invest some money into it. So because this is an open blockchain, a public blockchain, you can start building things on top. So everyone can download the blockchain. Not everybody can produce new blocks. Only the elected block producers can, but everyone can download the blockchain and you can start building on top of it. So there's quite a range of different projects. I didn't even list all the categories, but there's different block explorers, which are essentially browsers for the blockchain. Here's one of them called Fizzy. So you can see all the posts in a different form. There's lots of different bots. Steemit doesn't have any transaction costs, so you can all the transactions on the blockchain are without any fees. So you can write a bot, and you don't have to worry about bot going rogue. You can just keep upvoting stuff or downvoting with no cost. So there's lots of bots that you can interact with. There's browser extensions, games, other tools. So here's one of the block explorers. So you can go and you can look up everyone's account. So here's an account of Benedict, and you can essentially see all the activity of the users, all the upvotes, all the comments, how much money. here's a look at some of these bots. So what you can do and what's completely normal in the Steam within the Steam world is you can pay a bot, or you can actually bid on a bot, and if you win the auction, then the bot will upvote your content, right? So this is a form of paid advertising, essentially. So you can pay for your content to be upvoted, and there is no simple way of basically telling. If you look at a post and you see, okay, this post has $250 in rewards assigned, there is no easy way of telling, okay, this part has actually been paid for by, you know, paying one of these upload bots, and the rest has been, you know, organic kind of growth. No easy way of finding out. So here's a sad statistical chart. It's the last 6 months or so. It's been a number of daily posts seems to be trending down. That's just out of interest. So to close this, I just wrote down a few issues that I have with this whole system, right? So I guess the biggest one is the whole reputation system. So if you can transfer or delegate your reputation to somebody else, I think it also means something else. It's not reputation if you can purchase more for more money. It's just oligarchy. Then another important aspect is that the payouts for your posts actually only reflect a period of 7 days. So if your post doesn't get enough traction within the first 7 days, then you will get essentially nothing. So whatever uploads you get after the 7 days period, they don't count. And as we know, there's lots of posts that are useful in perpetuity, right? That you might be coming back for years, or quality content that doesn't get discovered immediately, that can be discovered later. The system of the 21 blog producers is not quite what we consider decentralized, right? It's just 21 entities, very easy for them to collude with each other and just upvote each other and vote for each other and keep the business going. I was actually very interested in the art blog, because as far as I can tell, there isn't really an incentive to post anything controversial on Steam, because if you have large whales swimming around and they don't like your content, they can just downvote you and take away your chance of making money. So, for example, I wasn't really what you don't see on the front page is political commentary, for example. It just creates this culture where everybody is trying to please the audience, right? Okay, a few more, and then I'll end. Okay. So, Steam is kind of a general platform, so they don't really have a mission. Like, Facebook is all about friends, and Instagram is all about your pictures, and Twitter is all about, who knows? So, I'm not sure what Steam is for exactly, so it's kind of tries to do everything and doesn't really do anything that well. Then in terms of the price, so a lot of people get excited by crypto, and this is the top 40 cryptocurrency out of more than 2,000 projects, right? So you would think it's way up there. There's a lot of money in this thing. And the problem is most of these tokens are not actually liquid, right? Because if you buy the Steam token, all the incentives are to lock them in the smart contract. And you can't take that money out easily. It takes 13 weeks. So if you want to get your money back that you've locked in your reputation token, you will get that money in 13 weekly payments. So you can't get that money out immediately. So that means a lot of these tokens are actually not liquid, they are not being traded, and that means the price is inflated. And yeah, to close this, the whole system is built on this proposition of content economy, and that's what they call it, content economy. So the idea is that people will just create value by writing, and that is a, in their mind, that is a self-sustaining system. But the way I think about it is it really requires this constant stream of new users and new investments, especially in the form of dollars and Bitcoin being spent on the token. So that's kind of the crucial question. Can you have a self-sustaining system that is printing money by inflation, where value is created just by people upvoting and commenting and posting their thoughts on paper? So, thank you. Maybe I keep the questions for later.
Yeah.
And,
I don't know. Is there any immediate question or to what has been explained, or should we continue? Okay.
I had some, but maybe it's okay.
Maybe we save them for later, and then we have a general discussion where everybody can answer, because I think there are different points of view, and it would be valuable if we can answer with a different point of view. Thanks, Jan.
As Shirley said, my name is Guido Schaefer. I'm a professor of economics here at the U. And well, recently, I've had several times the chance to participate in events like this. It has actually always been the same pattern. At first come the charismatic, enthusiastic, interesting crypto people. And in the end, then comes the great professor, which is me. And so I'm very happy to play this role. So let's see. And people still keep inviting, so whatever this means. I mean, one thing you see, I'm constantly trying to make my slides appear not to be the ones of the great professor. I'm not sure that I succeeded, so it's like you tell me afterwards. Anyway, so I'm going to provide a brief summary of some issues that might have been raised already, but then we'll keep on focusing particularly on the financial side of the platform, which is probably where I have most expertise in. So to make a long story short, basically Steam is a combination of two things. One thing is a social media platform, as we've heard already, combined with a cryptocurrency system. And as such, this is an interesting combination. When we talk about the social media platform, we have seen already one of the special things about it is that you get rewards when you write content or you curate content, right? So there are many other platforms, but on many of those you don't get a reward. Here the reward comes in the form of a token, right, which is the cryptocurrency token. Those rewards are proportional to the number of votes a person receives. You've seen this also already, right? So being able to convince many people to vote for you is critical to increase your payoff. But voting power is restricted to those Steam power users we have already also talked about before, right? And so the basic rule is the more Steam power you have, the more voting power you have, right? So this is critical for all this upvoting or downvoting that constantly takes place on this platform. Now, for me, the currency side is probably a more relevant. As we have already heard from Jan before, there are basically three tokens that play a role in the system, right? First of all, there is the Steam token. Jan already briefly touched upon that. So you can think about that as a kind of basic currency for the system, right? So it serves as a unit of account and a store of value, which is a typical function that money also plays. It has like money-like features, and it can be traded on an exchange. So in that sense, it's similar to what a normal currency, so to speak, would be. So if you want to enter the system, you have to buy those Steam tokens, right? However, once you own those tokens, what you can do is that you can convert them into Steam power. So this would be like locking in your funds. As Jan said, this has on the one hand the implication that it makes your token holdings illiquid. So you kind of devote your funds for some time to the system. The conversion rate is 1-to-1, so basically one Steam token is one Steam power token, right? So in that sense, this is fixed. And liquidity means that you have to basically leave your funds in the system for a couple of weeks, right? In exchange, however, you get those voting rights. We have talked about that already. And the nice thing is that if you are a Steam power token holder, you will earn a return. The return is again paid out in tokens, but here it may come in two different forms. One is again, you get more Steam power. The other thing is you might get also what is called Steam dollars, and those Steam dollars are designed as a kind of stable token which can be converted 1-to-1 into US dollars, right? So you do not only get rewarded just by receiving more tokens, but you also get something that very easily can be converted into real US dollars, so to speak, right? So that's the way how the system is set up. Where this is the default option. Actually, users can decide to obtain only Steam power, so they can say, we don't want the stable token, the Steam dollar. actually, also the system in times of stress or whenever, can say we are not going to pay out Steam dollars, only Steam power tokens, right? So in that sense, again, the point is that if you have invested into the system by holding Steam power, you get part of the newly created tokens in the system, right? And this, again, means either you get more voting power, you get more Steam power, or you get a token that can be easily converted back at a stable exchange rate into US dollars, right? And for some people who are concerned about the high volatility of cryptocurrencies, this kind of stable token can be attractive because there they don't run the risk of losing money if for whatever reason the currency goes down. So I already talked about this Steam power token, so the idea is again, to exchange one unit of the Steam dollar token into a US dollar. And it will be interesting to see how exactly the system ensures that this is feasible. The Steam dollar token can also be traded on an exchange vault and sold there, right? So in that sense, we've got two liquid tokens that are traded on exchanges, regular Steam token, the Steam dollar token, and then the internal token, which is the Steam power token, right? Which is like the vehicle for the influence you have in the system in terms of voting. Okay, we have basically seen already a very similar slide from Jan. Mine is slightly simplified. So one feature that is critical here is that each year a certain amount of new tokens is being created. Right? So this is basically where the rewards are coming from. So they are coming from the newly created tokens in the system. And there is a rule how these newly created tokens are being distributed among various stakeholders in the system. 75% go to authors and curators, so Jan had like a breakup of this number, right? So the idea is that most of the newly created tokens will go to the people who devote their time and energy to the system by creating hopefully interesting content or helping others to identify such content. And then, as Jan said already, 10% goes to the miners that are called witnesses in this system, and another 15% is the returns that the Steam power holders get paid. Right? So this is what I was talking before when I said as a Steam power holder, you are entitled to earn a return. So this is the 15, so where do these tokens come from? These are the 15% from the yearly newly created tokens here, right? So that's the way how a new supply of tokens is being distributed among stakeholders. And what is now also special about Steam is that the system is based upon an inflationary creation of tokens, right? So there is a steady increase in number of tokens for the indefinite future, in principle, right? Where very early on, this growth rate of new tokens was very high. It was like 100%, so it was doubling per year. However, after half year, there was a hard fork and people decided to reduce this growth rate of new tokens. And it has settled down now to somewhere below 10%, as Jan said. So it was 9.5, now it's 8%. And it will go down over the next 20 years to almost 1%. Right? So currently we are close to 10. In 20 years, it will be close to 1%, and there's a linear schedule of a steady reduction of those growth rates of newly issued tokens. Okay. Now, you could ask the question, so what is the idea behind it? Why would you want to have an inflationary token, so to speak, in the first place? And why would you want to have this schedule of declining growth rates over the next 20 years? Well, my interpretation here is that early on, basically the system relies upon creating new tokens to finance the incentives that the system requires to work the way it is designed, right? So for building up the system, you basically rely on token printing, you could say, right? So this is analog to printing money, with the printing press. Now, you could say, wouldn't this necessarily imply that the exchange rate between the dollar, let's say, and the Steam token would have to go down such that Steam would depreciate because so many more Steams are being created? And the answer is no, right? Because the countervailing force here is the growth of the platform, right? And so if many more people want to hold and use those Steam tokens, then, and this is also what really happened, then you will see that actually the currency rather kept appreciating rather than depreciating, okay? But the point is that, of course, it's unlikely that the growth of the platform can keep on going forever at the high rates that were experienced early on. And so it seems that at some point, there is a switch built into the system when basically the newly created tokens reach a very moderate growth rate. Right? I mean, it's not zero as for Bitcoin, let's say, but it's 1%, which is much less than, for example, the money supply of the US dollar, right? Which would be like, I don't know, 4%, 5% per year, right? So it's way above those 1%, right? And so the idea is that across time, appreciation should not come so much from the increasing popularity of the platform, but rather from the restriction of the token supply, right? So that seems to be the idea behind it. Right, now, of course, you've heard here fascinating success stories about the money you can make when you are on steel, and I find it really impressive, right? I think I never would be able to do that, right? At the beginning, when Sherman was a bit concerned that not so many people are here today, I said, don't worry, I'm an academic. I'm used to the fact that people don't read the books we write, they don't come to the lectures we give, etc. So I mean, in that sense, for me, I think I have a different mindset. But the point is that when you think about who can win here and who will lose in this system, right? It kind of seems too good to be true that everybody can just always gain, right? And so that's an important question, who wins and who loses in this system. Now, the first observation here is that as long as the scheme token, which is, again, the basic standard of value in this system, as long as this token appreciates relative to Bitcoin, relative to the US dollar, everybody will gain. Everybody measuring her or his wealth in terms of dollars or euros or whatever, right? Because even as a passive holder, just by holding the coin, it will increase in value relative to US dollars, and everybody else holding or having a stake in the system will probably gain, right? Now, if there is a modest depreciation of the scheme token, this still may mean that as long as you're sufficiently active on the system, which means that either you are a successful author, you're a good curator, you are a scheme power holder who has a right to earn returns due to the fact that he has got scheme power, then this means that you will have rewards in terms of scheme, right? And those increases will be higher than the depreciation, which will reduce the value of your holdings in US dollar terms, for example, right? So in that sense, a modest depreciation still doesn't rule out that people are happy about the rewards they get, and when they convert it back into dollars, they're still making a net positive return from all that. Now, should steam ever seriously depreciate, then of course it's a different story, right? Because then all the passive holders will lose. Also, being paid in steam will be nice, but when you convert it back into dollars, it will not give you a lot of value, right? And so you probably have to be a very, very successful author to earn huge rewards that even after converting them back into dollars or euros, you would still see a positive return on what you've invested in. So in that sense, I agree with Jan that the question of growth of the user base, of appreciation, which is a consequence of that, is a very important question for the longer term perspective of the system. Now, given that we've identified this exchange rate as a critical issue for the question whether really people earn rewards on net from the system or not, it may make sense to look a bit more deeply into the determinants of that. So it's like a market, right? So you've got inflows and outflows in this system. The inflows come from people who are new users, people who are already users of the system and decide to stock up their holdings, hold more steam, right? the outflows are basically people who cash out, right? So who want to convert back from steam into dollars or euros, okay? And then, of course, one definitely has to take into account also speculators who have other reasons to hold or sell these crypto tokens. And chances are that they do play also an important role, given the high volatility we've seen over the years in the token exchange rate. Right. I mean, again, as long as, so basically, when will the token keep appreciating? Well, when the inflows exceed the outflows, right? When do the inflows exceed the outflows? Well, if there are, it's a constant stream of new users demanding more of those tokens, and or when people, just in order to be able to make full use of the potential of the platform, decide to hold ever more and more of those Steam tokens. Okay? So in that sense, should at some point people get bored with the platform, or should people get nervous about the sustainability of the value in the system, and so should the outflows prevail over the inflows, then definitely depreciation will happen. And of course also if the speculators are depressing the token. Right? So in that sense, I think when you analyze the fundamentals of this platform, it will be the attractiveness of the platform, which will keep people locked into it, which creates motivation to hold those tokens. Right? So as long as the platform remains popular and keeps growing, I think there are good prospects for this system to prosper. Should this at some point change, then there will be a critical phase of transition. And the question is whether the system will be able to settle down to a kind of new equilibrium, new balance. And I think this is one of the bigger questions for the medium term and long term perspective. Okay, now this is a look at the chart of the Steam token. So as we heard, somewhere again in the spring of 2016, and we see that there have probably been some bubbly sub periods, right? When you see very sudden increases of the token and then relatively swift collapse. Still, if you compare the rate between the Steam token and the US dollar in the less bubbly periods, you will find currently it's somewhere close to one US dollar, right? And that's clearly above the levels reached here or also early on upon the emission of the token, right? So in that sense, if you exclude those extra, well, it's very special bubbly periods here, happening particularly in the fall of 2018, right? Then still you would get that on net, the token has gained value, has appreciated. And I think this is remarkable because this happened despite the increases in the token supply, despite the inflationary model that was behind it, right? And again, I think the reason is that the network has grown quite a bit during this period, and hence, for the users, real value was created. And so the willingness to hold the token on net also increased. But of course, we also see that it's a highly volatile currency, as most cryptocurrencies are. Okay, now, so what is the value proposition of the system, in my view? Well, me being an economist, I don't see it necessarily just bad if you finance early on a system through inflation. Okay, so for example, if you, well, there are arguments, for example, if you think about poorer countries that have less developed fiscal systems, in such countries, using the so-called inflation tax to fund government expenditure is something that is done on a regular basis and can have some rationale behind it, right? So in that sense, I think when you consider the alternatives of requiring people to pay fees, of requiring people to pay for content, I think this is all much less attractive. And in that sense, I think that's a smart idea, right? You just create the tokens and hope then that the value you create is more than the depreciation you would expect from an inflationary model, right? And as of now, it seems that for Steam, this has worked pretty well, otherwise we would have seen a strong devaluation. And this obviously hasn't taken place, right? So you don't have to impose fees. I would also agree to let's say, to what is said in the white paper that demanding fees in such a framework is like a killer, right? So this kills the system. So I think in that sense, if instead of that you finance it through so-called inflationary token supply, I think this can be a smart idea, right? We also heard that, of course, there are people who love the platform, right? Who enjoy a lot being active there. And so this is with, as with other social media, that it can be fun, can be considered as a game, you build a community, right? For authors, it can be a way, like bloggers, other people, it can be a way of easily monetizing your content without having to rely upon some other model. You just want to see it and the system does the rest for you. What one might critically argue is that I'm not sure whether all the people using this platform are fully aware of, you know, of the delicate balance between token growth, returns you earn, and the effect on your real holdings in terms of dollars and euros, right? So I think for many people, the fact that they get rewarded is great. They feel like, you know, earning something out of nothing. But of course, that's a bit too good to be true, right? So whether or not, in the end, really something is going to be left on the table. So I think that's the question. And I'm not sure whether everybody looks at things that way. I also think that there might be a factor which nowadays would be called a behavioral factor, right? So I'm alluding now to behavioral economics. I mean, we know that, for example, when it comes to investment behavior, the people who are the most active, who trade most often, who overestimate their abilities by the most, is young males. Okay, young guys, the people, they know how to beat the market, they, you know, they are the ones who can outsmart the others, right? And so I think here, you've got a system where in principle everybody can win, but in the end, of course, it's only, it's not everybody, but just a limited number of people. So when you have overly confident people, then this still will work. Of course, not everybody will win all the time, but so it might also exploit a weakness in the human mind. That tends to make us, well, I'm not a young male anymore, so I mean that's not applicable, but the point is that I think there is also an aspect to that, right? I said already, in my perspective, the fundamentals of the system are key, right? And the fundamentals are the attractiveness of the platform, because this means that you have got inflows of new users, that existing users want to hold more tokens. As long as this is the case, then and people do this because they like the platform, because it provides value to them, I think then there can be a brighter future for this network. But I think there will be critical times when growth recedes. We have seen in Jan's presentation that actually the number of daily posts seems to be going down. I don't know how it would look like from a very long-term perspective. And so, of course, we know plenty of examples of platforms that have lost popularity very quickly, and then the whole system will reverse. Okay, and so if that happens, then the currency will keep depreciating, as I said, and people will lose, right? The whole thing will become unattractive, and then there could be like a downward spiral being set into motion when the system collapses. So I think right now we are in the fair weather phase. So as long as the sun shines, it's a great system. Currency keeps appreciating, people get the rewards, they feel getting richer every day, so this, everything is nice. But if this should change at some point, then you will see how sustainable the value is that is being created by this platform. Okay, one slide about the Steam dollar. That's, of course, for me as a monetary economist, very interesting, right? Because it reminds me of peg exchange rate systems. For example, the Austrian shilling basically was pegged to the Deutsche Mark for a very long time. Okay. One thing that is well known in the Austrian context is that most such pegs, unlike the Austrian peg, break down at some point because the fundamentals of the countries diverge, and at some point the exchange rate becomes unsustainable. Right? Now, how does the Steam network deal with this issue? Well, one thing is that overall they try to keep this dollar scheme, dollar exchange rate constant, right? And the way they do this is that they simply adjust the value of scheme tokens that you can obtain, and which should ideally equal basically $1, right? So should the currency depreciate, you simply get more scheme tokens, right? Should you depreciate, you get fewer scheme tokens. So that's the idea. And on that, it should always be around $1, right? In a real world currency system, you would say you have to defend such a peg by holding currency reserves. Right? So if you've got a lot of currency reserves, then you can intervene in the market, and should the exchange rate get weaker, you can simply buy your own money by using a foreign exchange. Right? Now, there is no foreign exchange here, so the way how this works in this system is that you basically support this scheme dollar stable token by schemes, right? So there is a pot of schemes which is kept at 10% of the total outstanding amount of schemes, right? And this is kind of the surprising part of it, right? Because it's basically defending your currency with your own currency, right? And this is a bit paradoxical. Still, I think this does work, and it has actually worked pretty well in the past, as long as you issue a sufficiently small amount of scheme power gold, right? Because then, as long as your own token is valuable, then indeed you can defend this exchange rate for some time, okay? But given that the pot of schemes that are out there to defend this exchange rate is limited, so should you have a bigger amount of scheme tokens out there, then this would mean that at some point you would run out of reserves to defend the peg, and then also the scheme dollar would trade at a discount, so it would not be valuable anymore, $1. Okay. Right now, scheme dollars are about 5% of scheme, right? So this is low. Right? And so if you do the math, you will find that the system could deal with a depreciation of up to 50% of the token, right? Which is, not completely unrealistic, right? So this can happen, then you would have a problem. So in that sense, you could say it's a system based upon lousy reserves. Now, again, as long as the scheme token keeps appreciating, you don't have this problem. Right, because then you have to pay fewer and fewer schemes to defend the scheme dollar exchange rate. But should this reverse at some point, or should this dynamics not go on as now, then the ability to be able to defend your stable token will also go down. And so there is an inbuilt vulnerability to what you would call a speculative attack. Okay, so here is the chart for the spoon dollar. You see basically most of the time it has been at $1. It has never fallen much below that, right? So in that sense, the defense of the exchange rate was successful, obviously. When there was the big boom in the fall of 2018, you see that also the steam dollar appreciated for some time. Right? But then the system found back to the $1, which it is supposed to be. So in that sense, even though you might criticize this for general reasons, if you look at the actual evidence, it has worked until now, right? But there is no guarantee that this is going to continue forever. Okay, so now my conclusions. I think it's an interesting model. For me, the inflation financing of the establishment phase of the model is a smart idea, because I think it's better than many of the alternatives. I think the real risk will become more apparent as the growth of the platform dies down, and also as the growth rate of the token supply goes down, right? Because this means that the pool of rewards gets smaller, not necessarily in real terms, right? Because it's always the question what is going to happen to the exchange rate. But again, here, I think as people have money illusion, they will simply have the impression that they get lower and lower rewards from the system, which again might not be true if you convert it back into dollars, but you get fewer and fewer schemes, so that's for sure in the future. Right? And then the question is again, so will people get bored with the platform? If yes, then get out of it, right? Because then there is a lot of problems that will accumulate and might bring the system down. I'm not sure how much I like the Steam dollar, so I think it's probably a good idea to have a token which you can pick out to users that preserves its value in a predictable manner, right? So it's probably good, but I think the way how it's set up, it's shaky, right? So again, in good times it works well, but if there really would be a stress test for this system, so I'm not sure whether it would be able to withstand the pressure. Right? Strong pressure could definitely not withstand. And so in that sense, as I said, most exchange regimes collapse at some point. So this should be a warning sign for users. What struck me also when I read the white paper, for example, was that there are so many features of this system which look completely arbitrary to me. Right? So why is it 30 weeks that you have to lock in your token? Why not 12? Why not 20? Why not 200? Why not offer more than just one option? Right? I mean, why not have a short-term or a longer-term option there? And many other things. Why is it capped at 10%? Right? How do you justify the way how the pool of new tokens is being distributed? Why is it 75%? Why is it not 80%? So I think, and there are actually many more, probably more relevant details. So why have 20 witnesses, 20 miners here? So could make sense, but I don't see really the full reasoning behind it. Right? And in the end, it looks quite arbitrary in some sense. I also dislike the fact that when I really got more into the details, I found a lot of small print, a lot of footnotes. Right? For example, as a matter of fact, the rewards you get in dollars can be suspended. Right? This was like a small comment. I don't know whether the experienced users are aware of it. But so for me, this means that in times of pressure, when the system becomes unable to defend the pack, they will simply suspend it. Right? And so I think this should be clear to everybody who is using this system. And I mean, finally, so there is, for the economies, there is a big other part in the system which is very interesting, and this is how the incentive system is being set up. I admit I'm not a Steamian, right? I spent 1 hour trying to find one page I was interested in, and I failed, to be honest, right? But I mean, that's rather my problem, as a million people seem to have a different perspective on that. So whether this is really going to promote the best content, I'm not sure. Right? I think all these scoring systems and delegation of power and so this is very complicated. I think if you try to model this as a game theoretical problem, it would be extremely complex, very, very, so I think you couldn't do it actually. Right? It would be too hard because it's too complicated. Right? You could think about subparts, modeling, but I think the entire system is beyond being something you can capture in the game theory model. And so this keeps me skeptical a little bit, right? So I think it does interesting things, but when it really promotes always the best content, I'm not sure. So that's it.
Open the panel up to the audience so you guys can ask your questions.
for this system, maybe you should better tell us, but I think what is attractive for a user is that you can get paid in something which has a reliable rate by which you can exchange it into currency which you use for paying your bills, paying your trip, holiday trips, etc.
Investment, anything.
Right.
Yeah. So, or you leave it in the system.
Yeah. Or
you leave it invested.
Right.
Can you share how you used it?
Yeah, I can. The first year, I did not even think to cash out, as you call that. I just was interested to collect, and I was interested to build my own cryptocurrency portfolio, which means that I left the money there and I built my steam power that my vote was something worth. Otherwise, it would have been too difficult to grow my reputation. And I knew that it was very important to stay invested, that the platform can continue to exist. Meaning if everybody starts cashing out, it's logical that there will not be enough left in the pool, in the reward pool. So I really understood, even if I was not technically that skilled, that I cannot just take out, and sometimes I'm not even upset when I saw people doing this. So that was the moment when I started understanding that I have to build communities and have to start promoting this platform and the community and how amazing the people are, they are part of it. So you start promoting as a user. And then you know that the platform will continue. And
when did you use the stable token, or how did you?
Yeah. So the moment I realized that Steam had started gaining on value, I started taking a little bit and started investing in other things, and then I put it back into the system. I converted it. No. It depends. You have both. You have Steam dollar, you have Steam. It constantly changed. At some point you earn Steam, and at some point you earn only Steam dollar, or you earn both. Like what percentage I don't really care. Honestly, I don't care. But you get a percentage of Steam dollar and so. For your curation, as curation rewards, meaning how it is calculated, I really don't understand.
My question is, did you ever
power down?
Consciously use the Steam dollar or convert into the Steam dollar, because from what we hear from you, the role of the Steam dollar is
you have an option where you can trade inside the system.
And yes,
you do, because at some point the Steam dollar went up to, I think, $9, which was like a big confusion, but it was fantastic for all of us because we started the. Changing our Steam dollar as quick as possible and bought Steam, and then that was the moment where I started to cash out and invest in other coins.
Okay,
because that was purely a game.
But you didn't, in fact, use Steam dollar as a stable currency. Way around. So the design, what I'm trying to get at. It was designed to be a stable currency, but it's not being used from a user perspective.
Which is
stable currency.
Yeah.
Is it, or is it just you? You know many other Steam users.
Yes, I do.
So do they use Steam dollar, or they just took the advantage of the high price and they cashed it out?
Exactly. I mean, I don't know what others did, to be honest. I don't know, maybe you know. What did you do, Alex?
When you left, for example, very good option to have a trade, to have the possibility of trading within the system. Very important.
Yeah. You see.
Yes, I mean, I think, just to back up, so I think it's not a stable currency necessarily in the sense that it's supposed to like replace the dollar, right? So I think it is a very specific function within the scheming system, and I think that's mainly what people use it for.
Yes,
right?
That's
so you don't want to replace your dollars, but when you are in the system, you're happy that you are able to convert it.
And I see it more as the investment I keep there in the system. I'm not really taking it out. I'm speculating more on steam. So the steam dollar is more, it's a side product for me as a user who doesn't understand that much about the economic. Yeah, it's just there. It's good to be there, and if you're lucky, then some investors make mistakes and invest in steam dollar instead of steam, and then it's a little bit messy, but it was fun.
You maybe have a comment?
I have a question actually. So you said at one point you were reinvesting other funds back into steam.
Yes.
Can you just explain why?
Oh yeah, I'm like a baby trader, but I was lucky, on and off, I'm lucky or not lucky, but I'm taking out and putting back. I want that this platform exists and does not die. And I have to admit that in the last 2 months, I'm not writing, I'm not active, because I'm working on a different platform. So we are building something else, and it's supposed to be better than Steam.
What is it?
It's called Olo, and it's a Chinese-based, still centralized. Should be decentralized, but we're working towards being decentralized. So, anyways, there should be improvements, but I'm not. I love Steam it. I really like the.
So one of the things you were mentioning in our private conversation, and we also talked about, because you can delegate Steam power.
That's
this is being done. Steam power is being dedicated to trading bots that are optimized to where you can then share your revenues with the trading bot, and the trading bot is optimized to bring out the maximum value of the steam power that you dedicated. And does any one of you have the numbers of, have you looked into the numbers of the steam bot activity?
I just know in terms of voting for the witnesses, you can see that roughly half of the votes come from delegation.
So the upvotes for like people delegate their steam power to trading bots, so they can maximize their profits.
Yeah.
And it's not about delegating. The intent is not to delegate their votes to for blockchain based activities, but just to maximize their revenues. So what I'm aiming at, the system was designed in a way that it doesn't favor, as you also said, necessarily curation of interesting content, whatever interesting means in the eye of the beholder, but it's favored at curating content that makes you maximum money by liking content that is posted by people with high steam power, because when you like that, you can make more money, vice versa. So, where do you see the, what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, and there's this whole thing about you get all these awards for your posts, and there's always a nice picture that, so it has been gamified to a degree as well.
That started at some point, and it's actually really global. It destroys the whole ecosystem. The whole upvote feel really annoyed with this, because I feel that as a user knows the system from the beginning on, we were really working hard on building, and the moment you even started being excited when you see yourself in trending page, because for whatever reason, maybe you've been lucky that a whale, which is a big investor and big C-Power holder, voted for you or found you. Maybe by accident, it has nothing to do with the content, but you got good votes. Now it's boring. It's really boring because it's just a game in between. It's a bot game.
Yeah.
And I also delegated some of my power to the Steemit Austria bot, because we were supporting the Austrians with a so we have to. You have to compete if not Austrians don't have the chance to get votes. So we somebody created a computer and voted all the Austrians. They used the hashtag I created, which is called Steemit Austria. So we were like, that's the way how we all ended up meeting each other. And say,
referred to is if you
either you need to a lot of time to build reputation, but you can buy steam power with money by putting, you can buy steam with fiat, and you can convert steam into steam power. And I think it was just a miscommunication, or it was not very clearly communicated. In that sense, it creates this unfair balance that you have. We had this one slide in the presentation I once did, where the whales have like 90% or even more, 95% of all the tokens, and the majority, then you have a few dolphins, but the majority of the users have only 1% of the tokens. So there is no fair balance of power within the network, and it's because you can buy the so-called reputation token with fiat currency through Unigia. You have to go through loops, but in the end you can buy your reputation.
Yeah. But you can also be fast and grow your stream power by dedication. So for example, I know one guy who just started, and on the other day he was away just because he got a big dedication.
Yeah, but it's an unfair system, that's the point.
Yeah.
So, I mean, the question is, still it's an amazing system. The question is, do we, if we design the next decentralized social network, what can we learn from that? Would we design it in the same way as Steemit, or would we learn from the design that we can see here? And then the question is, who will participate? There was another comment from you. You're also a Steemit user?
Mm-hmm.
Yes?
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Thank you for this interesting introduction to Steemit. I'm also a very passionate Steemit user, and I'm also a cryptocurrency lover. And I have blog on Steemit about the same topic we discussed today, about the sustainability, which is a very interesting topic, and you did quite a good job to focus on the steam power economics. But in my opinion, there are two major streams of e-money to the steam economy which you totally missed in your talk. Number one, steam is a cryptocurrency, like you said, and even by being a cryptocurrency, it has value, because cryptocurrencies are the most modern, most interesting thing right now in society and economics. And even if you put the social media part away, just being a cryptocurrency creates some value nowadays. So even there are 2,000 cryptocurrencies, most of them even do not have a product, but have value. So this is the first stream of money. Just by being a cryptocurrency that is traded, it has value. Then the second stream of money is steam power economics, which you quite well described here. And the third very important stream of money is, if you look to the year 2006, Facebook was created like a university project and so on, we all know that. Who could have guessed then that this company that builds a free website based on social media could earn billions, $40 billion each year just by offering a free system? Who can imagine this this year? And the reason is because they have a new business model based on data collection, and advertising. Mm-hmm. And basically, Steemit also tries or has this potential. So if it becomes successful, the companies want to publish something, they also need to invest into the platform, they need to buy the Steem dollars to make advertising. So you can actually sustain a social media, a free social media system, just by advertising. So you even do not need the cryptocurrency stuff, the Steem power stuff, just by advertising. Okay. So you will totally told us about this very important aspect.
Yeah, I think there are many, also another, thank you for this input, there is also another aspect we haven't talked about. But you just kind of mentioned it.
blockchains that everyone can see everyone's activity. On Facebook, only my friends that I permission can see my activity, and Facebook knows everything about everyone. But on Steemit, the whole world can see everything that you post, that anything that I post, any and everyone who liked something about me. We have applications because everything is transparent on the Block Explorer. There are many applications that build on top of Steemit that analyze user activity, for example. There are a few. Do you want to mention a few of these apps?
And it stays on the blockchain, so it's immutable. Right now, they want to change it after the hard fork, but it stays there. So
yes.
So,
but
as
that,
as a user, I was interested in that.
So
that I have the power over what is public or who owns what I post or write.
But
so because I want
public.
That it's, I'm very aware of what I'm writing, and I want that it stays there because I'm very honest of what I'm saying, what I believe. So in 50 years, in 100 years, it's still there. I'm happy for that. But maybe Facebook people and Google, they do whatever they want with my words. But with this, with Steemit, I can be, let's say, 100% sure that it will be the way how I said it. And that was one of the reasons why I actually started.
Okay, because it's censorship resistant.
Makes that sense, that I want that it's transparent.
Well, that's a personal decision, but I think what is important to understand is that on Steemit, everything is transparent to everyone. Because of the type of cryptography that is being used, if your username is, if you identify yourself, your personal identity behind your username, everything about your actions is transparent.
Yeah.
But it's transparent to everyone, which means that no single entity owns your data.
Mm-hmm.
That data is public to everyone. And I think this is a very important thing we didn't really discuss in the presentations, but which we need to understand. Now, I think when it comes to privacy, you might think that this is very good because you want to be radically open and transparent. Other people might not want that. And I think very important aspect is that nowadays we have things like zero-knowledge proof cryptography that Zcash works with, and Ethereum wants to transition from the regular type of cryptography to zero-knowledge proof cryptography. And if if for example Steemit would use it, no single entity would hold the data. You could run big data, or you could have what we call transparency with full anonymity at the same time. So what I'm trying to say is that what we're seeing with Steemit is a snapshot of state-of-the-art blockchains, but this transparency part might be changing soon when we use, if and when, the next projects, like for example Ethereum that is transitioning, start using zero-knowledge proof cryptography.
That's where other developers are learning from, because they can you don't have a choice on Steemit to hide your post and to choose if it's private or if it's public. So this is definitely a problem because you don't have the choice. I like Steemit because I don't mind it's public. And I know that my pictures are stored on an extra storage place, so I know what I put out, I'm fine with it. But for other users, they should know that it's not possible. And that's where others can learn from, that you have the options on the blockchain, that you can collapse it, or you hide it, or you make it private, or only see only you, etc.
Okay.
On Steemit, it's not possible.
It's not possible. So what's the comment to that?
So it's true that there is censorship on Facebook, of course, like on other platforms.
Yes.
But on the other hand, it's also true that Steemit is borderline illegal. So they don't care about copyright and they don't care about anything. So it will not work very long. So there are pretty a lot of problems. And the lawyers will have fun with all the users which don't care about the legal stuff because it's on the blockchain and it's
mentioned is all the copyright aspects, which again, other blockchain solutions are already finding solutions with, for that. Steemit has not done that.
Yes. Just also to quickly answer to your question, which is related to your comment, I don't think that the mere fact that you are a cryptocurrency means that you're successful. I think cryptocurrencies are a radical innovation, right? And as we know from radical innovations, most of them actually fail, right? Like more than 90% will fail, okay? And so I think in that respect, and it could, for example, be for legal reasons, as you just suggested, right? So I think this is an optimistic view of cryptocurrencies, which I would not share, and hence I didn't mention it in my talk.
Just one comment with regards to Facebook business model, right? So what makes Facebook valuable is they sell our private data, right? They don't sell the public stuff. I mean, they sell everything, but they especially like selling the private data, and that's what makes, you know, advertisers excited.
But now there is no privacy.
Exactly.
On the
so
it's zero privacy at the moment. Yeah. Other questions?
Yeah. I have a follow-up question on the misalignment of interest. So on the one hand, we have people who want to maximize the profit, and on the other hand, we want to establish a system where we can curate content. We had a talk on the last Crypto Monday about the convergence of systems. So in the end, that every network converges to some state, and only a few people benefit out of it. My question would be, do we have data or do we know who benefits most from the current behavior on Steemit?
That's another good point. And if you look at the history, what went on in the early days, there was a lot of confusion about who was able to mine or not. There was no KYC or AML on the developer team. And from what I've seen, it really looks like for quite some time, they were kind of mining for themselves until they opened up the mining to other people. So, and because of course there's no, you know, you can create as many accounts as you want, you can delegate the power to somebody else. There's just no transparency. We had no idea how much of the tokens do the developers still have, you know, and you will not find that information.
So we don't know where the value goes to, basically. That is,
yeah.
We don't.
So, we know it goes to big players mostly.
Okay.
So. One name we know.
it's a damn classic, isn't it?
So you had a question. We'll answer all the questions.
Yeah, was one of us.
Okay, I only wanted to mention that I was in disagreement with Jan's talk when you talked about the controversy topic. Yes, it's true. When you sell your soul to a whale, then you won't have any controversial topics. But I think we are much better on Steemit than on Facebook, because when you look at Art Poet or Chris Kind, he's very critical on Facebook. He gets regularly blocked there. And on Steemit, you can't get blocked. So you put out your information, you put out your art, your critical controversies, and it stays there on Steemit. Even if it's, I don't know, like pornography or something else, you can use the not safe for work tag. So you're really like free on Steemit, and you can have your controversies when you stay, you don't sell your soul to a whale. And
but
I even
you can't make money. Like you want to optimize making money.
It depends also on your community work, because when you're highly valued within your community, then you can have like a collective or a critical art thing, and then you still can earn money. That depends on how good you're a communicator and a community maker.
Yeah. Another question?
Remark, because you just said that it's not transparent where money is going, that's actually not true. You kind of look up in the blockchain, you will see every single steam power where it is coming. Like, if you look at the rewards pool, you see where it's dropped, you can see exactly which user got which amount of steam power over what time, so it's not interest-bearing.
Yeah, but what I meant was we don't know who owns these accounts. So we know exactly which accounts, but we
yeah, you don't know the real person.
Exactly.
Yeah,
that's what I meant. interested in who's making the money, not which account has what.
But you can see if it's like the account that was there early on, or it's like the account that was there later. So
yes.
Every account, you have the exact data when it was created.
Yes.
So basically, the accounts created in 2016 will be the creators. You can see which money is going where. So it's not interest rate.
Yeah, 80% is owned by the founders, and the cash out rate every week is about $2 million for the founders, so that's the clear cash flow.
It's a good cash flow. There was another question,
Colin? Yeah. You just, before in the presentation, you said something about there are no transaction fees on the blockchain, on Steemit.
Right.
So could you please explain how they avoid spam, since most, or as I know, all cryptocurrencies have at least a small fee to avoid spam? How do they solve that?
I think they have some specialized bots to find stuff like that, but there's experts here.
They don't have specialized bots. It's if you have a certain amount of fee power, you get the right to transact on the blockchain. So you don't have a direct cost, but you don't have to pay the actual cost. But by owning fee power, you get the right to transact on the blockchain. So if I have like 100 euro invested, and you're 50 euro invested, I have like double the rights to post. Like with very little amount, you can't post infinitely.
So it's some kind of centralization via power or important.
With having power, you gain the right to transact on the blockchain. Like if you are a new user, you will have enough power to be like a normal user, but by just opening an account with like power of 50 euro, you're not able to make 1,000 transactions per minute or something. So you can spam the blockchain. That's also what I wanted to say. Steemit is actually just one front end of the Steem blockchain. Like the interesting thing is the blockchain itself, because when you think back to fall, December, whatever, when you look, Steemit was the 25th valuable, but it's not about the value, but on the transactions. When you look at what were the most active blockchains back then, everybody was talking about Bitcoin, Ethereum, blah, 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 blah. But the most active blockchains were ours. Like, blockchains having the most transactions were BitShares, EOS, Steem. But that's the interesting model of Steem for users, because you don't actually pay the costs. By having invested in it, you can transact for free, so you don't directly buy.
Yeah, the three projects that Dan Larimer made,
yeah,
you just listed. Yeah, yeah, that's a really good point, because so as a new user, your ability to post and comment is highly restricted, right? So I think you can make like three comments in a day or
no. You can, but you have normal interactions.
They
just make normal interaction. You just can't go there and spam 1,000 users.
Right, right.
So I registered as a normal user. I didn't pay money, and I was able to use it as a normal social.
And I have a follow-up question for that.
Yeah.
Is it okay?
Yeah,
so,
sure.
Because Jan, you also said before, it's mining, so it's proof of work and proof of stake via holding.
No.
How can you unite this?
No, this is pure proof of stake. So you elect those block producers. So 20 producers are elected by the Steem Power based votes, and there's one random rotating one, so there's 21 in total, and they each take turns producing the next block.
So it's only proof of stake count?
Yes, so that's how you can get the performance, right? That's how you can, it's easy to synchronize 21 machines within 3 seconds.
They call it delegated.
Yeah, that's the thing where you can let somebody else vote for you.
Maybe just an observation or a comment. After following the discussion here, it comes into my mind, just an observation, we had this, a lot of the stuff that's going on here reminds me on the gray-haired people probably know the expression, but the young folks here probably not. It appears a lot like a big virtual Tupperware party that's going on here. You know Tupperware?
Yeah.
It was this stuff, you know, and it was very, very successful for a while. All these pyramid systems, also insurance companies, you know, the direct selling of insurance policies, and so it goes very well for a while, but it depends heavily on growth. As long as the system is growing, everything is fine. Yeah? So you have to build a community, you invite your friends, you talk. So yeah, I have the impression that you build a community. And as Guido also said, it has to grow, the system, it is damned to grow, but at a certain point it might collapse. That's the risk inherent in such pyramidal kind of systems. Yeah? And Tupperware also failed in the end, by the way.
Okay, the
the same to your comment about the Ponzi schemes and the MLM scheme. And so if you read in the PDX white paper, there's a nice diagram showing the self-regulating system in proof of work, proof of stake. So if there is less interest in the community, the reward is increasing because there's less there are less people in the system for dividing the rewards. So it's similar to the Bitcoin difficulty. If there are less miners in the system, you have more less difficulty. If there is more miner, there are more difficulty. You can compare it to this. That's why it's not a Ponzi scheme.
Another aspect of it, I think that's it's another type of inflation. It's hyperinflation. If you look at the reward in the first phase and you compare it with the newcomer reward, it's a hyperinflation, I think, factor 1,000.
But
that's another problem.
It has
several aspects of pump and pump and Ponzi scheme. Of course, it's as said in the presentation, we are in a sunshine phase, or maybe the sunshine phase is over. And it works for some time if there are new users and new money is coming into the system. It's just a matter of time when it collects.
If you like, we can go to the storm front later, and I explain it to you exactly why it's not a problem.
I think that discussion is very interesting, right? And we're seeing a new paradigm here because we're moving away from the platform economy where value was locked in, value in the form of owning data was locked in. And we're moving to a network economy that is incentivized by a token system, or there are multiple token systems. And I think these new network economies have much more similarities to nation states rather than to companies. So the vocabularies need to and the methods we need to start using to understand this new phenomena are micro and macroeconomic tools rather than the tools we know from business administration. So my question to you when you listen to that, it really is a very important discussion, but the same is a country. Is it a Ponzi scheme? We could have the same discussion, right? And a country needs to make sure that the monetary policy is tied to the economic fundamentals, because if you don't, you have hyperinflation. So I think everything all of you are saying is quite valid. How can we tie it to the know-how you guys bring in? Maybe a few shared thoughts.
I basically agree both with you and with you, and I think that's possible, right? So I do think that, as has been said already several times now, growth certainly helps a lot in establishing the network and in making it popular. But I would agree with you that you could think about the system working without new users coming in, and still remaining stable as long as for the existing users there is enough interest and enough fun and enough incentive to just keep your tokens and use them to be active on the network, right? So I think these would be like the fundamentals of the system. So because you asked about the macroeconomic side of it, there's a famous theory in exchange rate theory that tries to explain why catching up economies appreciate the currency. So that's typically what happens, right? If you think about a country that makes big progress in terms of producing prosperity, typically their exchange rate appreciates. And so in that sense, you could say as long as, so if the analog to a growing country there is a stable and strong, not necessarily growing platform that is growing because of a steady inflow of new users, but just because the people who use it like it and use it intensively, right? So I think then you will have, relative to the number of tokens, more and more people who want to hold them, and this will maintain the price, right? Still, I think it remains true that should the popularity of the network go down at some point, this would be a big blow to the system, and then I think this fair weather argument has quite some power. And so there are all kinds of, you know, of death loops that could be set into motion that could bring down the system. I don't think we are there as of now. I mean, what I find a bit, so can anybody of the users maybe comment on the slide that Jan presented, where you could see the number of postings was going down? So is it just the time slot he was looking at, or is there anything else behind it?
Yeah, comment.
Because there was also, do you have a comment?
It was just a comment. The activity just went down because of the price. You clearly see that, like, people, I know people personally who just wrote, like, very intense scientific articles, but it took, like, dozens of hours to write a long article. And of course, before they got, like, maybe $1,000 for it, instead. initiative to get active was way higher on the price side, but like the other guy said, relatively seen, the activity didn't drop as much as the price dropped. So in relative terms, I think it's actually a gain in activity, even though of course the price slowing down, the activity drops.
It's also just a comment, and I want to take it from your point even further. As nation states are opening more and more through globalization and the technologies we have to interact economically and politically, these systems, and Steemit is for me just one use case and one sandbox solution for doing something, just exchanging information that has some value. We are just valuing it. I think the next interesting stage of this connected and network economies will be when all those platforms or blockchains start to be interchangeable, have interchangeable coins, so that the value can be transferred from blockchain to blockchain. I think this will be the next step of this. And then it will show which value the interactions or the information we share and we trade actually have. When we can trade them for other values. I think we're at the first stage of trying to get a grip of a really decentralized or distributed capitalism. In terms of the information is the good. The blockchain is the infrastructure that is owned by all of us. And this means we start to own the means of production, so it will be a real decentralized capitalism in terms of markets.
Following up on your comment about the monetary policy, it would be very interesting to see, because the lock-up period of 13 weeks is, to me at least, only a trick to slower down the velocity of the money transaction. I don't know. So if you would get rid of this mechanism, it would be very interesting to see how the value or how the interactions within the system would react. Because when you do not have a lock-in or like a reason to keep like staked in the currency, because you don't have to, people might get out quicker, and then we would not capture the value in the currency, I guess. I don't know.
I think wasn't there a lock-in period early on, which was like 2 years, so it was much longer, right? And then users complained, and then the rules were changed, right? So in that sense, it has become much more liquid than it was, but obviously it did not yet, at least, lead to the collapse of the system, right?
Is this, you have a point?
Yeah, it's two commands to this liquidity. The lock-in period is necessary, otherwise the system wouldn't work, because you vote with your stake. And let's say I have three accounts. If I have one account, I have my whole stake, vote with the whole stake, and then transfer the stake immediately to the other account. If I could do that, I could vote with having one time a certain amount of stake, I could lose the stake, vote, transfer to another account, vote again, transfer to another account, vote again. So if you don't lock in the liquidity for a certain amount of time, the whole system wouldn't work, because you could use your stake to vote a dozen times, but of course everybody should only be allowed to vote once with the stake. And to the lock-in period, it's not that the rule, liquidity is locked in for 13 weeks. If you have, it's like, if you have a certain amount and you start to power down, you get 1/13 every week. So you don't have to wait 13 weeks until you get the whole thing, you get it step by step.
So it's even more liquid.
Yes. So I would suggest, I think, we're running into 2.5 hours. Last question, and then last kind of comment round from you guys.
One last short question.
Yes.
I saw your first slide, and I've seen the first time I came here at this
use case, how many questions are related to only one use case. We have micro and macroeconomic questions, we have copyright questions, we have privacy questions, etc., etc., etc. And we just like scratch the questions, and we haven't even started coming up with answers because it's very complex. Network economy, multi-stakeholder economies that is governed by a predefined set of rules that is tied to a token, it's a highly complex thing. And this is why we started this institute, and I hope that in this Crypto Monday series, we're trying to bridge the gap between research and what is happening out there, and have a few and we hope to see you again, and we will have a Steemit account next time you come. Okay, for sure. Okay, last comment, but then...
Yeah, I just think it's interesting to say that the Steam blockchain will have problems because of copyrights. That's like saying the internet will have problems because of copyrights. Because every user has to be... It's every user's duty to look for his content is uploaded. Just like if I open up a website, it's my responsibility to have the website without any legal stuff. It's not the internet's fault if I upload something illegal.
Yes.
So if I...
So I feel that we're having recurring discussions every 20 years when the internet upgrades to a new operating system. And maybe last set of comments to all of you. My last question would be, what is your learning you take, especially for our researchers here, from dedicating some time? So what will the next, what did this inspire you to look deeper into Steemit or similar?
Okay, I mean, to be frank with you, I had no idea about what Steemit was. So actually, I was introduced to it by Sherman. And then I started doing research on it because I thought, like, well, there will be experienced users, and I don't want to, you know, want to keep a straight face when I'm up here. And the point is that the more I learned about it, the more I found popping up interesting economic questions, which I had seen a long time ago in a very different context, particularly with respect to economics of currencies or very basic questions about what money is, how the monetary system works. And so I think in that respect, we are still very much on a steep learning curve, everybody. Some of the things I read about Steemit I find incredibly naive, I must say, right? So, like, for example, I mean, all these ideas about that the token creation rate equals the inflation rate. It's not true, simply. And there are many other things like that. But on the other hand, I'm deeply impressed by all these young people who are actually putting into reality things I have studied, like, I don't know, 20 years in pure abstract theory and never would have considered that to be anything practical or useful in the real world context. And these guys just go out and do the programming, you know, issue their tokens, rake in a lot of money, ideally, and create a lot of examples where you as a researcher can tremendously learn from it, right? So I think it makes sense for both sides to work hard to get closer and to create more mutual understanding, because I think in the end this is what is going to help the whole process.
Yeah, for me what was interesting is it kind of makes you realize, you know, this being a top 40 cryptocurrency, you know, how powerful these things are, and how you can create this massive economy, right, from somebody's garage, right, and so it just shows you that there's, I think, a lot more to come from this space, and I think it was a very interesting use case to look into.
That's exactly what I had in mind, what you started. I think in every community and in all different areas of development, first the internet and then so many things I was witnessing over the years. So I think if you, continue to improve the systems and the blockchains, you can have a lot of profit and value coming out of it, especially because there are smaller communities building and they can really be very powerful in their effects. And I can see that because I was never expecting that there is so much coming out of that. So it's not only the earning and the money and the copyrights and the privacy, it really doesn't matter to me. But for me personally, I've learned that people can be very powerful even if there are a lot of assholes behind. Sorry to say that. It's clear that it's not all perfect. It's so clear, but I don't mind because I just pick out the reasons and I make the best out of that. So if all of us understand that, then why stop it? Just do whatever you feel it's good to do. But I stop here because I could go on. I'm sorry. You have to get the best out of it, and the developers, they understand how to improve. Just work it out, you know, work it out, make it better, like they do already. Us users, we do our part, because I started promoting much more than I thought I would be capable of. So I started finding skills on my own in this kind of community where I helped and inspired and motivated, and it is very fruitful for the communities that users turn into professionals in their own ways, and that's what you said. There's a lot of power behind, you cannot really control. That's all that I'm trying to say.
Thank you so much, all of you, for taking the time of coming, the speakers as well as the audience, and for these wonderful contributions. And I see that half of the Bitcoin Stammtisch is here, which is great. Thank you for coming. And I think there's still maybe beer outside. Some students are celebrating.